Hello. Now I am going to give you a brief introduction to Spock. Okay. I think to start, I suggest to start that you read from the Spock documentation, the Spock primer. I think that it explains the main concepts, so will be enough to start, plus read our code, how do we use Spock, and in particular the demo or the videos that where I use Spock to implement my functionality. Okay, so and then as you need, you can learn more from the documentation, but I think this is a good starting point. Okay, so what you need to know, and I've already explained in another video, is that basically what is basically the structure of a test. Okay, so if you want to test something, you need to define first the context, usually is what is called setup. Then once you have set up the context of the test, you actually stimulate the part. So you send the stimulus to the part that you want to test. So you invoke the methods you want to test. And afterwards, you check the results. You see if everything is according to expected. If it's not according, you just throw some, give a, so the test framework just detects it and reports that the test does not pass. And finally, you clean the context. Okay, so that's why I'm going to give you a very brief introduction to this document so that you see what are the points more relevant here. Okay, so the important points to start, basically, as you see, all the test classes should extend from specification. As we'll see in our case, since you are testing persistent entities with JPA, we actually JPA. We actually have annotations there, but we'll see that in the other video. Now I'm just addressing Spock, just pure Spock without any particular context. Then you have the fields that you can define. So Spock basically is the test in Spock is in a class. This class has fields, and usually is a good idea to initialize these fields in the setup so that every time the test runs, you just clean and you execute the setup again, and then you just clean the state the state of the object that implement that is executing according to the class, and you run in a new context. Okay, everything is clean. Then you have fixture methods, so you have the setup method and the cleanup method. So the setup and the cleanup methods run every time before each test and after each test. And the setup specification and cleanup specification you may be necessary if you will have allocation of resources that are basically shared by all the tests that are going to execute in the context of that method. Usually of the class of tests. Usually this type of thing is relevant when you have something that I cost, and so you prefer doing it only once. Then you have the fixture method, so your test. So it's nice because you can use a string to write the name of the test. It's a string. It's nice because then you have the understandability, okay, of the test code is something really nice in Spock. Okay, so I think that's one of the big differences for the JUnit is that they provide a nicer way to so the tests are much nicer to read. Okay, so you can write the name like this because pushing an element to a stack on the stack, so you can have this, and then you have the blocks. You have here a synthesis of the blocks that you can use, but basically you have the given blocks, the when and the then blocks. The given blocks is if inside one test you want to define something in the context that is only specific of this test and is not shared by all the tests of the class, then that's the right way to do it. If you in the context of the test is something that is shared by all the tests of the class, you can do it in the setup. Okay, so basically here is given, so that's how nice it is to have this syntax. So given a stack and an element which is push me, Then you have the when and then blocks. And in the when blocks, you do the stimulus. For instance, in this case, when you push this element into the stack, and the then is where you check the results. Okay? And just to check the results, you only need to have Boolean expressions. And then if the Boolean expression is not true, what is going to happen is that you get a report that the test failed. So in this case, I'm checking that the stack is not empty, that the size is 1, and the element is there. Okay? So a few things more that you can see. Basically, here you don't need to... So inside the then block, if it fails, basically, you look at the Boolean expressions or something, or conditions or something that checks off the test. If it's outside the context of the then you need to use assert. So if in the setup you want to check something, you need to use assert as assert, because it's not expecting to check the correctness of the test here. Okay. Another thing that is nice is that if you want to say that what they expect is that when you do the operation, you expect an exception, you just need to do a throw. Okay? And then it says, okay, this test to pass, this exception should be thrown. And of course, this is just something, because then it doesn't interrupt the test. Okay? It actually caches it, and again, you can test other things. For instance, test that the stack is not empty. And it even allows you, in this case, that you receive the variable. So we receive the exception that is thrown, and you can analyze. And you can analyze the values in this variable to see that everything is okay. Okay? So you have both things. And you can even know that it's not thrown. So you have an expression, I think, here, and where you can check that you do a test and you check that the exception is not thrown. Okay? Okay. Then you have mocks. We are not going to talk about mocks in this phase. And you have the expect blocks. And the expect blocks basically is in situations where you can do everything, the stimulus and the evaluation, so checking that everything is okay in a single expression is nicer, okay? That instead of using an when, then, you just have an expect. So in this case, you just, this is the stimulus, and here you verify if the result is okay. Okay? Cleanup blocks may be necessary, so it's the opposite of the setup. It may be necessary if you want basically to free some resources. Okay? So if something fails, also that you free the resources. Okay? And I think it's this. Oh, there's a final thing. You see in the code that you have these tables. So you can have some things like this, where you have this test and it runs for each one of these values. Okay? So in this case, I'm testing the max of two values, 4. So we have A, B, C. So you have 4, 3 values, 2 values that are here. Okay? So if you want to know more about it, I'm not going to talk about it, but you can study a little bit about it. You go to this data-driven testing, and we'll see how you define the templates. But I have another video where I explain you how to use the templates in the project, and I think contains what you need to know.